excited to be here, and thanks to Dysautonomia International and particularly Lauren for inviting me to be here and to have the opportunity to do this research study here during those next couple of days. And I wanted to tell you a little bit more about that here in the next few minutes. So I wanted to tell you a little bit about why we are doing this study. So there has been a lot of interest in the idea of autoimmune mechanisms underlying POTS and orthostatic intolerance. That actually goes back to when it was first described over 20 years ago. Those folks back then even thought this likely is an autoimmune problem, just based on the various characteristics of the disease. And when we evaluate patients with POTS and orthostatic intolerance and run tests, we have stumbled over and over over antibodies of various nature in our patients. Those were occasional findings initially. We didn't really know what to make out of them. There were various different ones, so it wasn't really clear why some patients had these abnormalities, but it was interesting. But then research advanced, and there are some very interesting studies that came out over the last few years that actually showed that there are autoantibodies, antibodies targeting your own body, that are targeting certain structures of the heart and certain structures of receptors that are responsible for your autonomic nervous system to work. So those exciting studies, though, were met with some skepticism at first. The methodology used was a little unconventional and people remained a little skeptic. And so we thought we'd look at this closer with a collaboration with a lab at Mayo who have been doing autoantibody studies for over 30 years. And there are certain antibodies that are very well validated and really no one can criticize. Those are known to be associated with neurologic disease. And so we thought if we look and see in a population of patients with POTS, how many of patients have these well-established antibodies, we have something to work with. And that's something we did now over the last couple of years. And it may not be a surprise to you, what we found is that a good third of patients with POTS actually has these very well-established antibodies that are targeting nerve structures, and in this particular case, likely autonomic structures. And interestingly though, what these antibodies bind to are mostly thyroid gland antigens. There are antibodies of varied nature that we found, but again, 36% of very specific antibodies were identified. Now, we do think that what this indicates is that patients with this condition have an autoimmune tendency. They are likely to have autoimmune disease, more likely than the normal population. We do not think that the antibodies we identified are direct markers of the disease or are causing the disease. I think there's lots of work to be done, and part of that is what we want to accomplish here today and tomorrow, to find an antibody specifically causing or specifically being associated with POTS. But what our preliminary findings suggest again is that patients with this condition have a tendency to have an autoimmune problem. And so what we are planning here now is something that will take place over the next couple of days, and we will ask you to volunteer for participation in this research. We want to recruit over 100 patients if we can. We have a good team here of folks very experienced with autonomic testing, with blood draw, with filling out questionnaires and designing questionnaires, and we hope with their support, we get close to 100 patients studied during this conference. And what we want to do really is to confirm what our preliminary data have shown. Again, that a large group of patients has this underlying autoimmune tendency. And then we want to focus in on specific antibodies that are actually causative or at least associated with causing the disease. And so I anticipated some questions about what you may be wondering about, and I have those listed here, and I go through those first, and then I give you a chance to ask questions. So first question is, who can be part of this study? you have to be a conference participant, and you have to want to participate. No one is going to make you. It's totally up to you, totally voluntary. You have to have a physician-confirmed diagnosis of either POTS or orthostatic intolerance, and you have to be between 14 and 50 years old. We are approved for that age range. Unfortunately, if you're 13 and 11 months, we can't. And if you're just above 50, we can't either. And you have to be in that age range. If you have any concerns about any other disorder, any other medical condition you have that you think may interfere with what we are after here, just let me know. As we're going to be readily available in the room where we do the study, we can discuss and decide if the study is right for you. What we will do during this study, well, first off, it's a research study, so we need your consent. We go over the specifics of the study itself, and then we sign a consent form. You are able to ask questions and, again, decide if you want to participate or not. Then you get a study ID, an ID number that is the only way we can link your results to your testing. So we will not be able to link you directly with your name, your address, or any other identifiable information to the study results unless it's through that ID number. And you're the only one who will know what that number is. Okay. Then I will do a brief exam with you. Just looking at your joints, how mobile your joints are, and I also want to take a look at the skin and your legs and feet as they have been dangling down to see if there's any unusual discolorations that I can see. Very quick thing, will take a minute or two. And then you move into the actual study, and the study has three aspects to it. The first thing is a survey. You basically sit down on a computer station and fill out some questions about your disease, about problems associated with it, about your medications, etc. The second station is a sort of quick and dirty autonomic test. We brought some cards, we brought a device to monitor your blood pressure and your heart rate, and we have you lay down for 5 minutes or so, record your blood pressure and heart rate, and then have you stand up for 5 minutes and continue to record. And then afterwards, we ask you how you felt. This is being done by David and Tony. They are two very experienced autonomic technicians. They'll work with you. If you have any trouble, if you have symptoms, let them know. They know what to do. And at the end of that, you would move on to our blood draw station, where we draw a small amount of blood to do our antibody testing. This whole thing should take less than an hour. You can participate only today or tomorrow. This is it. It's only done at this conference. We'll start right after my talk here and go through tonight. Plan is 5 o'clock cutoff, but we will probably go longer. And tomorrow we'll start around 8 and again, keep going the entire day. You don't really need to prepare for this study. You don't need to worry about stopping your medications. You want to take your medications normally, like you normally would. Please don't show up right immediately after a three-course meal. That would probably not be a good idea. But other than that, the only other requirement we have is that if you wear compressive garments, support stockings, abdominal binders, take those off before you come to the study room, because that could clearly influence your blood pressure recordings. How long will the study take? I mentioned we anticipate less than an hour. There could be some wait times. Not every station is going at the same pace. There could be a technical problem that's holding us up a little bit. So I would give it about an hour if you plan to participate. I think that should be safe that we can complete with all aspects within an hour. Can you choose what to participate in and what not? Not really. You can't just say, oh, I'd like to fill out the questionnaire, but I don't want to do the rest. That's not helpful. We have closely linked all these aspects. And so we ask you, if you want to participate, do all three parts. Another important question is, well, if you volunteer to do something like this, are you getting anything out of it other than helping science? And we do plan to share the results of these antibodies with you. I can't guarantee exactly when I can share this with you. Some of these antibodies are already available, and those should be resulted very quickly. Other antibodies we're still trying to discover and develop, so this may be a year, 2, even 3 years from now. Eventually, though, the results will be shared with you, but the only way we can share them with you is through your study ID. And so you get a printout of your study ID, hang on to that. Otherwise, we would not be able to link you back to your results. So that's very important. And then the next question that may come up is, well, you found an antibody, what am I going to do with it, right? And so the honest answer to that is, I don't know myself yet. Which means it may indicate a certain tendency towards autoimmunity, and it will certainly also depend on what type of antibody it is. If it's a specific antibody, a non-specific antibody, and as research progresses, we will learn if the presence of this antibody means that we should treat you in a different way. But we don't know that yet. And so at that point, I would suggest you hook up back with your doctor, discuss the findings with them, and then decide if there's anything to act on. I can't really directly give advice because you're not my patient, and I cannot advise you to do certain things a certain way because of that. And I assume there may be other questions, and I'm going to be happy to answer those.
I'm just wondering, is it okay if it's hyperantigen POTS?
Is it okay if it's hyperpots? Yes.
Okay.
Yes, that's fine.
Hi. I'm wondering if you're planning on testing the parents at some point, because it would seem like if there's a genetic predisposition, or that way you can find out whether the disease itself results in the autoimmune problem.
Yeah, that's a very, very good point, and I think this is something that it's definitely a very interesting thing to plan for the future, for maybe next conference or the conference after that. We can't do it at this conference. This is designed that way, it's approved that way, so we can only study patients this time around, but it's a good point. Yeah.
If you've had IVIG or plasmapheresis in the past, mm-hmm. are you still allowed to participate?
Yes, you can. Part of the questionnaire that you fill out actually asks that question, and so yes, definitely you can.
The initial information that you published, or you showed there, is that available in any way to be able to show to physicians?
Actually, at the CME tomorrow, I'm going to share that. We have presented those findings back at the Autonomic Society meeting last fall and at the American Academy of Neurology meeting this spring. The paper is in preparation and should actually be published relatively soon.
Mm-hmm. If you follow our Facebook page, it's been posted a few times.
That too.
And I believe we have your poster from the American yep. Academy of Neurology meeting. We'll have we're going to have all kinds of research posters hanging up in the end hallway.
Okay, you said POTS specific. What about neurocardiogenic syncope? This is a different form of the dysautonomia.
Yeah, this specific study really is targeting POTS and orthostatic intolerance associated with POTS. So this is not the vasovagal syncope alone. Now, there's some patients with POTS that have vasovagal syncope on top of it, and that is fine.
What if the patient is on immunosuppression?
That is okay to participate. Again, we will capture those kind of questions in terms of what medications you're on and what you've previously been treated with as part of that questionnaire, and so we can correlate them with the findings.
Why did you choose the age range?
At age?
Yeah, I'm too old.
Sorry. it was sort of a practical decision. We know that there's a certain age range that POTS typically occurs during, and it's usually the teenage years and then early adulthood. Now, some patients we are aware develop the disease outside of that range. There's 7-year-olds who have symptoms very much characteristic of POTS, and there's much older patients. We do believe, though, that the mechanism underlying those specific patients are different from the majority. And to keep the population homogenous for the purposes of this study, we kept it to that narrow age range. Sorry.
If you're pregnant, can you participate?
Yes, you can. We would like to only include patients at an early stage of pregnancy, because in later stages of pregnancy, again, changes occur that could affect the results. So we'd like to limit it to the first trimester.
How are you going to use the data that with the heart rate and blood pressure when a lot of people are on medications that are controlling that?
Yeah. So that's clearly a limiting factor. We are aware of that. Ideally, we would take you off medications. The thing is simply impractical, because we would have to have given you way advanced notice. We wouldn't know if it's safe in an individual patient to take you off medications and for how long. And so it was simply not practical, and we'll have to work with that imperfection.
I was wondering, do you actually treat dysautonomia in POTS patients at Mayo, or is your primary work in research?
So, currently, my primary work is in research. I am a practicing physician at Mayo, but over 80% of my time right now is in research, so I have relatively limited clinical time. That changes as funding support changes, and when I first started out, I was much more clinician. Now, currently, I'm more of a researcher, and in 2 years, it may change back to be mostly clinician again. That's very flexible, luckily, at Mayo. You can really go in and out of interest, and from research to clinic, back and forth, depending on funding allows.
Do you think that these antibodies could be the reason that most of us have positive Hashimoto's tests?
Could well be.
Okay.
It could well be. I would disagree, though. It's not most of you that have the positive Hashimoto's. For example, in our study group here, not a single patient had actually known thyroid dysfunction. These antibodies were discovered in patients where it was completely unknown. But there's clearly a certain percentage of patients who have that problem, and there could certainly be a link.
So that would be the reason why, like, your TSH is abnormal and your T4 is not? Or?
It can be. Right. It can be, yeah.
That's what led to me.
Okay, interesting.
Yes, I wanted to know, that gives me a transition to ask you, in your findings about 30% of POTS patients could have this autoimmune problem, is it all kind of POTS with EDS or without EDS, primary POTS or not primary POTS, mm-hmm. with mitochondrial disease, etc., etc.? Mm-hmm. Is it a kind of POTS or it's all POTS, all POTS mixed up?
Yeah, so that's a very good question. What we did is we looked at our characterization of patients and tried to link those were positive to the antibodies to a certain phenotype. What turned out to be the case is that those with positive antibodies had, to summarize, a hyperadrenergic state. Their blood pressure, their heart rate was much higher than the other group. Their catecholamines in the blood were higher, and so it seems to actually match the so-called hyperadrenergic phenotype best. Again, this is rather preliminary, it's a relatively small group, and how that holds up, we will see.
The 36%, that was the organ-specific antibodies. What
Correct.
Was the percentage for assorted non-organ-specific?
Any antibody was about 45%. But the thing is, that also increases by about 7-8% in the general population. And so it's about a 30% increase over the general population overall.
Who's your control group?
Who's my?
Control group.
You don't have a control group specifically for this study. We do have a large lab control cohort. So we know we have about 300 subjects that were healthy and were just picked out of the general population for the frequency of antibodies in general. And that is being used for, has been used for the last study, and it will be used for this study as well. So for this specific study, there's no control group, there's only patients. Thank you.